Half hour, here is what we're watching for you. This breaking news from President Trump. He is accusing former President Barack Obama of wiretapping his phones before the election. Now, this morning, the president tweeted, "Terrible. Just found out that Obama had my wires tapped in Trump Tower just before the victory. Nothing found. This is McCarthyism." And is it legal for a sitting president to be wiretapping a race for president prior to an election, turned down by court earlier? A new low. And I bet a good lawyer could make a great case out of the fact that President Obama was tapping my phones in October just prior to the election. How low has President Obama gone to tap my phones during the very sacred election process? This is Nixon, Watergate bad, or sick guy. Joining me now, NBC's intelligence and national security reporter, Ken Delaney. So, Ken, these are some serious allegations that the president fired off early this morning. Is there any substance to where he's getting this information from? And if so, what does he have to back it up?
Thomas, these are incredible allegations. And the answer is we don't know. And we're trying to find out right now whether there is any substance behind them. The thing is, there's a Breitbart News story. That conservative website had a story alleging that there was a FISA warrant, a Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court warrant to wiretap Trump Tower. And we're wondering this morning, is that what the president is talking about? Or does he actually have information? Presumably, he could call the FBI director and ask him. The question would be, though, if there's an investigation targeting Trump associates, would the FBI director brief the president on it? So many questions here, Thomas. I mean, but what if it's real, it would involve a Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court warrant. That's a national security investigation, and that would allow the FBI to intercept communications. Normally, those are targeted at foreign diplomats, spies in the United States, but they can be targeted at U.S. persons, at Americans, if there's suspicion that those people are cooperating with foreign intelligence or involved in an espionage case, for example.
And as we talk about spies, let's talk about what we know on your reporting about the former British spy who allegedly put together this dossier last year. He was going to be paid by the FBI. They stopped paying. They didn't come through with that payment, as I understand it. But his investigation on whether or not the Trump campaign had any contacts with Russian aides during the election season. What do you know?
That's right. So Christopher Steele, former MI6 operative, former British intelligence agent, wrote this dossier, which it seems like a year ago we learned about it. It was actually just a couple of months ago. And this dossier alleges a conspiracy between the Trump campaign and the Russian state to play basically a dirty tricks campaign on the Clinton campaign and help Trump win the election. Now, that's completely unproven, but We learned that the FBI was prepared to pay Steele to continue his investigation. As you said, that arrangement fell through. Now the Senate Intelligence Committee, which is investigating this whole thing, is in talks or is considering calling Steele to testify or gathering information from him. Now the problem is he is in hiding and he is not inclined to come to the United States, sources tell us. So and the other issue is the FBI pretty much and the U.S. intelligence community knows much of what Steele gathered because he cooperated with them before. So he may not be at the top of the Senate witness list, but his information is the basis of a lot of these questions that the U.S. intelligence community is investigating, Thomas.
All right, Ken Delaney. Ken, great to have you with me. Thank you. I appreciate it. Attorney General Jeff Sessions will amend testimony from his confirmation hearing on writing, submitting that by Monday, about his contacts with the ambassador to Russia during the presidential election. He'll also provide written answers to any additional questions. However, Democrats are not satisfied with his recusal from any campaign-related Russia investigation. And the House Minority Leader, Nancy Pelosi, says the connections go much farther. Take a listen.
What we see is a very narrow recusal. I'm going to recuse myself on the investigation of the election. No, there's a whole Russian connection of personal, political, and financial Russian connection. This is just totally unacceptable.
So joining me right now is Boyd Matheson, former chief of staff for Utah Senator Mike Lee. And Mike Lee sits on the Judiciary Committee. Sir, it's good to have you with me. And let's talk about the issue of Jeff Sessions. And this is obviously kind of a drip about his credibility as the top cop in this country between the Trump campaign and certain surrogates and members of the Trump team to this Russian ambassador. Do you think that he can clear this hurdle?
I think he can. I think the recusal is the first step to that process. And the big thing is that everything just needs to keep marching forward. I think one of the biggest challenges to the Trump administration is they keep getting distracted on unforced errors. And usually that happens because they don't have an agenda and aren't focused. Arguably, you could say the two best moments for the Trump administration, the rollout of Judge Gorsuch and his speech last week, were good moments for the administration, but both of them have been marred by their inability to take the agenda forward. So they get distracted. There's a set of disciplines required in running the administration, and they don't seem to have grasped that that's what they've got to get to. And that really starts with an agenda. So I think as it relates to Attorney General Sessions, if they want to move forward, they've got to move forward. And tweeting early in the morning and taking shots at these different things isn't the way to do it. I think there's a lot of things we don't know yet in terms of that interaction. Clearly, the Russian ambassador is not the most memorable person. There's been over 30 members of Congress who have had multiple meetings with him and had no recollection. So I think there's a lot of murkiness still out there. But for the administration as a whole, they have to quit this herky-jerky approach. You know, it's true. Most administrations kind of wobble out of the gate.
I mean, if you're a surrogate for the person that's running for president that has asked Russia to hack into Hillary Clinton to find the 30,000 missing emails, and then the September headlines are all about Hillary Clinton saying that, yeah, the Russian intelligence community is trying to interfere with our election. And then in the beginning of September, you're Jeff Sessions and you take a meeting with the Russian ambassador. Don't you think that's going to have a more memorable effect?
You would think it would, but there's a lot of those. It looks like it started under the education program was the initial meeting. And again, I don't think we have all the details of the other components yet. And so we'll have to see how those play out in terms of what those meetings were, where they were, and what the context was.
Don't you think with Jeff Sessions, though, and because of the fact that there is such interest in finding an honest broker who can assure the American people that we weren't messed with in this election, that we have fair and accurate results of what the 2016 election demonstrated. For Jeff Sessions, it's not about any alleged crime right now. It's about this alleged cover-up or impropriety. And isn't that the bigger issue, that there is a lack of credibility because he could have easily demonstrated that information in front of the Judiciary Committee? That may have saved a lot of headaches today.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think that's part of the disciplines that I was talking about, Thomas, that you have to look at these things in the full context. And how do you get out in front? Most administrations don't fail because they don't have the right agenda or the right focus. They fail because they let the weaknesses become the dominant part of their behavior and their actions day to day. And so clearly, Jeff Sessions had an opportunity to clarify or to be specific in terms of those interactions. And again, that's part of that discipline process that we just haven't seen yet from the Trump administration.
So when we talk about the agenda, and we know that President Trump wants to repeal and replace Obamacare, and there's a sentiment certainly on the Hill about how to get this done and how to do it well, Senator Mike Lee wants to repeal and replace it first, replace it later. For people in Utah, aren't constituents afraid that if it's taken away and not completely something put in as the safety net that's supposed to fix it, that something won't really come and that health insurance will go away completely?
Yeah, I don't think there's that kind of fear, because I think there's a direction. People understand that, yes, we've got to have some sort of safety valve, safety net in there. The states can clearly do that better than the federal government can. That's been seen over and over. And it's something that happens really, very well here in Utah. You know, Utah is thriving and functioning well because we keep things to the local level. And we recognize that the health care dollars and decisions need to be local, not back in Washington, D.C. So, no, there's not the big fear and outrage that I think a lot of us want to get to. And I think it's also important, Thomas, to recognize that this is really both parties' issue, that we have so many of the leadership in both parties who recognize this as a wedge issue. Both parties raise massive amounts of money, and I don't think we're nearly as divided on health care or immigration as a lot of our leaders in Washington want us to believe, and a lot of outside groups in Washington want the American people to believe, because they know as long as the American people think we're too divided to solve health care or immigration, right, it gives Congress an excuse to do nothing. It gives the president the excuse to do whatever he wants with an executive order, and it maintains the status quo. And that's the thing the American people have got to get to, is we've got to hold our elected officials across the political spectrum accountable for getting to real results. We can have a dialogue about health care. We can have a dialogue about education. I was always amazed in Washington. I thought we could solve 94% of the immigration issue in an afternoon because everybody agrees on the vast majority of it. But we have people who use it as wedge issues to win campaigns, raise billions of dollars of money, and that's why, you know, most of the richest counties are suburbs of Washington, D.C.
Boyd Matheson. Boyd, good to have you on. Thank you for your time. I appreciate you getting up
early.
Thanks,
Thomas.
Take care.
Thanks.